Hi everybody. Greetings from California. I was going to say good morning everybody, but then I realized that it's only morning for some of us. So good afternoon to those of you who are local to the workshop. I'm Matei Chokorlie from Willow Garage. I'm very glad to be here today, to be there today virtually. I don't know where I am, to participate today virtually to tell you a little bit about some of the work we do at Willow Garage on shared autonomy over the web. So let me start the screen share and switch over to my slides. I'm going to share the desktop. Okay. So hopefully you can all see my slides now. And this is really joint work with my colleague Kaijian Xiao, who is with me in the room this morning, and the Willow Garage Interactive Manipulation Group, the Web Robotics Group. This is the team that has participated, that has contributed to the things that I'm going to talk about today, and most of the credit goes to them, and I will talk a little bit about some of the components that they've helped put in. So what I want to talk to you about today is shared autonomy over the web, and where does that come from? Where does our interest in that come from? And Guoqiang was talking earlier about robots in the home and robots in the workplace, and that's a very compelling direction that we very much want to get to, but it's just the nature of the beast that with the technology that we have today, the range of scenarios and of things that a robot has to do in a home, and just the sheer variability of the environment can be too much for autonomy to always succeed in, for autonomy to always be able to handle. So we think that a very powerful paradigm is a robot that is, for example, assisting an elderly person, or a robot that's operating in an unstructured environment, being assisted over the internet by teleoperators or by simply by people, by operators. And the image that I have here, on the left-hand side, you see, a robot assisted by multiple operators. One thing that we're thinking about is that, these operators, some of them, they could have different hardware available. You see one of them. I don't know if you can see my mouse cursor, but one of them has, just a computer and the mouse. You can imagine, a haptic device or even a more involved cockpit, and they are assisting the robot as the robot is doing a useful task in a user's home. And actually, a paradigm that we think is extremely powerful is moving past the usual teleoperation paradigm, which is one-to-one, one operator teleoperating one robot, and getting really to a many-to-many paradigm, where a number of operators are available to assist a number of robots. And this is what the image on the right shows, the same operators, but actually connected to multiple robots. And we think that that can be an extremely efficient use of resources. And really, a robot assisted by remote operation like this might be able to do useful things in houses, in real homes, soon. Essentially, we would like to enable useful applications today, as soon as possible. And we think that human-in-the-loop manipulation is one way to do that. And if you think about this many-to-many paradigm, how do you connect many operators in many parts of the world to many robots in many parts of the world? And the answer is obviously the internet, the cloud. So this is why our focus and my talk today is centered on this notion of shared autonomy over the web. But in order to achieve this vision, what are some of the main difficulties? And there are quite a few, but the main three that I've listed here, ultimately you need these remote operators to control a very high-dimensional system that's doing very complex tasks in difficult environment. And even more, you would hope that many of these operators don't need expensive, difficult-to-get hardware. So you'd like the operators as much as possible to have ubiquitous hardware on their side, which that generally means, a mouse and a computer, right? So a 2D monitor, a 2D input device with which you need to control a very high dimensional system. Obviously, communication is a huge difficulty, and the speakers before have mentioned it already. And ultimately, also, if we are to have lots of operators assisting many robots, we're really hoping for this notion of many, many robots out in the world. Not all of these operators will be expert roboticists. Not all of them will be, from the audience at this workshop today. So we need to enable robot programming and operation by non-experts. So these are three of the main challenges for achieving this vision. And what is one possible solution for this? Ultimately, communication bandwidth, you have to work on that. There's no two ways around it. But One thing that will help, I think, with all of these problems is this notion of shared autonomy. And we think of it as this spectrum of robot teleoperation. At one end, you have what you normally consider low-level teleoperation. At the other end of the spectrum, you have full autonomy. And I will argue that a robotic system is never at either end of that spectrum. You're always somewhere in the middle. That slider that I'm showing here always moves left, moves right, depending on how the task is going. And you can imagine a robot doing a task in a home is autonomous as much as possible, which is great because it makes it a lot easier for the operator. It reduces the amount of data you have to transmit over the web. But when autonomy fails, then the slider moves to the left. The operator takes over with more intensive teleoperation tools. And this is what we normally refer to as tiered human in the loop. So let me give you just a very concrete sort of bite-sized example of what we mean by that for grasping. And here what I'm showing is grasping based on object segmentation and recognition. Here you see the robot has segmented and recognized the objects on the tabletop. And at that point, all the operator has to do is say, pick up. And the robot completes the grasping task fully autonomously. This even works on unrecognized objects as long as they can be segmented using the grasp planner that Kaijen wrote. Here, however, if let's say that grasp, that segmentation and recognition fail, then I'll have a video that shows it better in a second. So if segmentation and recognition fail, then what we can do, we have a different option at our disposal. So here's a very cluttered scene where segmentation and recognition don't work. Here, what the operator is doing is saying, this is what I want the gripper to go for grasping. And you can still have autonomy helping the operator. Here you can see it's requesting that a grasp planner tries to adjust the position of this virtual gripper. But still, it's the operator's job to do the refinements and to position that virtual gripper the way they want it. And then once they say, you know, accept, the robot goes ahead and executes the grasp. And still the robot does the motion planning and the collision avoidance to go ahead and execute the grasp. So it's still a lot easier for the operator. Obviously, if, you know, this is again an example showing segmentation and recognition. If this works, it's the easiest version for the operator. You have to transmit the least amount of data. But it's important to have options that allow grasping to succeed, even in other cases. And then finally, the most general situation here, the lowest level of teleoperation, here the operator is simply doing a Cartesian teleop of the gripper in real time. And we claim that, you know, this will always be useful and necessary. There will always be cases when you will need this lowest level of teleoperation. Because there will be cases where human cognition is needed to complete a task, and that's just the way it is. So here, for example, you can see that the same tool is being used for opening a drawer. Let me actually play this video one more time. Here, what the operator is doing is pushing down on one side of the plate so that the other side will rise in the air so that the robot can go ahead and grasp the plate. And this is something extremely difficult to do autonomously. But having this low-level teleoperation tool enables the operator to complete the task. So basically, for grasping, we have all of these levels ranging from fully autonomously, where the operator just has to say, pick this up, to low-level teleoperation Cartesian control being used to pick up the object. So moving on, well, what about the internet, right? Let's take all of this over the web and put it into the browser. And make, you know, let's have this interface that the operator is using run inside of a web browser. And we think that's a very powerful concept because web browser really is ubiquitous technology, right? You don't need a specific operating system, a specific version of Rust or anything. Anybody has a browser installed. The web and, you know, browser technology is the ultimate tool to democratize access to robots. Anybody can control robots. So let me show you the exact same interface running inside a browser. So now I'm going to move over back to Chrome. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to go to our central robot access page. And here you see, I hope you're seeing my my Chrome page right now, all the robots at Willow Garage that I have access to. So for example, let's say I click on PRM. This is a robot that is right now online and available. So now, if I go into this tab, what you can see is essentially my teleoperation interface for controlling the robot, as well as a live streaming point cloud from the robot into the browser over the internet. And Alper talked about the difficulty of streaming RGBD data over the internet. And yes, we ran a lot into the same problem, and we think we have some interesting solutions for that. Julius Kammerl developed a very interesting compression algorithm that then uses a popular streaming codec for getting this point cloud data over the web. And here, what I'll point you out is that I have the same three-dimensional interactive markers that I can use. And the interactive markers are, some of you might know them, they're a framework for creating robot interaction tools. And we have an interactive marker client running in a browser. So if you have an application for controlling a robot that uses interactive markers, that is, you can simply control them from a browser using the client that we have. And then I have access to much of the same tools. So for example, if I say, I ask the robot to segment and recognize the objects that I have in the image. And now you can see the robot has segmented the objects on the tabletop and recognized a few of them. And now I can simply right-click and say pick up using right arm. And now the robot does the motion planning, the collision avoidance, computes a grasp, and goes ahead and executes it. And right now it's still motion planning. So now you can see it's actually executing the grasp that I requested. And you know, if that fails, I always have the option of, you know, going to low-level Cartesian teleop. Now I have the object, so I'm just going to go to Cartesian teleop. I can move the object around. I can do just about anything I want. And all of this is running in a browser and over the internet. So switching back to the presentation, a bit of a shameless plug here at RASCON, which is going to be right after ICRA in Germany. Brandon Alexander from our team will be there to present all of these technologies in great detail, including point cloud streaming, for the browser, interactive markers in the web, and essentially all the web-based technologies that were developed. So to wrap up, told you a little bit about human-in-the-loop robotic manipulation, and in particular, shared autonomy over the web. And there are many applications, we think, to this technology. And the fundamental things that we're concerned about, again, reducing the communication bandwidth, simplifying the control of a very high-dimensional system, and allowing robot programming and robot operation by non-experts. And we think that this can enable many, many applications. If you think about the notion of co-robots, right, which is something very important, a very important trend in today's research. For example, in the United States, the NRI program is focused on co-robots. We think enabling non-experts to operate robots is going to be a big, big part of that. The web is a hugely important tool for enabling this, and we think that this is a step, you know, on this path towards robots in daily life, which is something that we're all striving for. So with that, thank you very much, and any questions? Okay, I guess we can move on and to the next speaker. Thank you again for the invitation to participate.
Hello, hello. Oh, now I see you waving at me. Can
Okay, good afternoon. I'm Shuichi Nishio from Japan, and today I'd like to introduce our work about cloud network robotics. So first of all, thank you for inviting me to this nice workshop, and I'd like to thank the organizers. And my talk would be a little bit different from the other talks. I would rather focus on more application side about the net robotic services. And my talk will be describing about our efforts about composing robotic services, high-level robotic service based on the cloud infrastructure systems. Okay. So if we think about supporting our daily activities by robots, there's many things to do, like, you know, cutting the grasses, cleaning up a room, you know, or going out for shopping, or, you know, just doing laundries, kind of things. And especially when we think about supporting the old persons, like after we became old, we will even need more helps. Like we would have some disabilities in walking or going around. We have to go to hospitals. We have to take care of, you know, many different kinds of medicines, and not forgetting to drink it. Oh, it seems that my slide is not progressing. Let me see. Okay. All right. So you have there's a lot of things that we have to ask the robots to support us, and it's important to notice here that it's not just many tasks that we will expect robots to help us, but also we have to ask the robots to help us in many different places and also under different contexts. Okay, so that's why we started this a project for robotics for life support, like combining different kinds of robots in many different places, and there are many challenges like how the robots should interact with human beings, or how should they collaborate, so it's many different kinds of robots or sensors, information systems. And also, just like in the previous talk, we have to think about having a people inside the loop of the robotic services, that is that we need to have a teleoperation system to always to support the robotic service, because the artificial intelligence system is not sufficient enough right now. Okay, but when we think about this kind of systems, there are many things that we have to think about. Well, originally we have been thinking about using a network system that is called network robot systems, that is for combining many different systems using the networks. But when we think about such kind of a system, like comparing with standalone robots or multi-robot systems, the network robot systems actually do have benefits that it can combine many different robot systems. I mean, heterogeneous, different types of robot systems or sensors. But it's not enough for doing, you know, a wide area, large scale, at a support for our human daily activities, because we go around in many places and we have many tasks that we need support. So that's why we started thinking about a system, a new system that is called the Cloud Network Robotic Systems, which we call CNR. Okay. So thinking about these kind of things, there are many requirements or challenges. Like, for example, we have to run robotic many types of applications by using or combining the devices that is available. We can't always expect to have a same kind of a robots or same kind of systems always available. Or, for example, for the sensing system, we can't expect so sensing systems to always provide the same precision of data to the services. So we have to always, you know, combine and have a kind of a system for deploying those different systems, and based on application requirements, okay, and also on the resource usages. Or we also have to think about abstracting many different kind of devices and systems for easily and dynamically combining those systems. In this sense, we also need some kind of a standardization of interfaces for exchanging data and also controlling many different devices. And also we have to think about how we can continuously provide services across different areas. And it's not just about network roaming kind of things, but also we have to think about how to combine or how to smoothly, you know, pass a service between the different robots or sensors. And also we have to think about how we can provide the services in different ways. For example, if we just think about some kind of a navigation service that the robots support people go around, if the person has disabilities in walking, we have to think about, you know, having, for example, wheelchair robots to support the person. And if the person is quite healthy, the robots can just follow the person and tell the route. So it means that the quality or the ways of providing a certain kind of services might be changed based on the attributes of the person who has to get the support. And also, as always, there's a lot of issues concerning privacy or safety or law issues, security, reliability kind of things. Well, especially privacy would be an issue here, because we have to get a lot of information about the person who is going to get the service itself. Okay, so considering these kind of requirements or challenges, we have started the projects to partially realize these kind of a system. And one of the implementations that we have made is what we call the Victus Network Robot Platform System. So this is kind of a centralized system that controls, gather the information about the available robotic devices or sensing systems, and also trying to combine those systems and provide seamless, continuously going services for networks. Okay. And for example, as one of the fieldworks, we have been doing services in a shopping mall supporting the old persons. The old person, for example, first reserved services at home using a smartphone, and then she goes on to the shopping mall and she waits for wheelchair robots to come here and to navigate her around the shopping malls, notifying her what she should buy today, kind of things. And always the teleoperator supports her. Okay. So there's many things that we have to think about in these kind of systems, like and also we tested lots of case scenarios, like for example sequential switching of the services or interruption, parallel kind of things. Okay. And also recently we have been applying this system also to the the chicken robot of the nuclear plant in the Fukushima area in Japan. We had a disaster 2 years ago, and now part of our system is being used for the system also. Okay. So that was one of our implementation, but we have to also think about how about developing these kind of robotic applications. Like it's not clear right now for many robotic systems, but there's many layers of who is going to use such kind of a robotic systems. Normally, we have many kind of a existing middlewares, but those are mainly aimed for robotic developers who has lots of knowledges and who can do programming kind of things. But if we really think about making a lot of applications for these kind of daily activities, we have to provide an easy and understandable interfaces for application developers who is much more closer to users. So that's one of the challenges that we have right now, and for the application developers provide a more abstracted kind of an easy programming system. So that the users doesn't need to, understand various types of series or data types and such kind of things, but can rather combine various modules easily and in an abstracted level. Like, for example, we don't want to control precisely where to bring the robot's hand and so on, but we can just want to say that please go to the shopping area B, a kind of thing, so pick up that bag or take me around for shopping kind of things. So that kind of large atomic kind of a service module should be provided and can be available to full combination. And in our implementation, we did such kind of thing, and we also distributed the platform system into several hierarchical systems and also into different areas. Okay.
I'm afraid we'll have to wrap up, otherwise we'll really run out of time.
Okay, so I'll skip about this part. And so I've just quickly went out about the system. So if you want to know further details, please refer to these kind of systems. There's also we have made an article about our systems, and also we provide a sample implementation about the system. Okay, thank you very much.
Oh, beautiful. Okay, great. All right, I'm just gonna assume everyone can hear. I do want to say thank you to everyone for the presentation so far, and I'm extremely delighted that there is so much interest worldwide in these topics. It's it's what I'm going to do and try to keep us back on schedule is just go very quickly through a number of points. One of them is that this, I want to point out that the ideas of connecting the network with robots have a really nice history. They go back to 1994 and even earlier with the idea of when the internet came out, there has been an ongoing interest in networked robots. But I have to admit that the word cloud robotics is much preferable. And I've adopted it, and I want to thank James Kuffner because he deserves credit for that particular terminology. The idea, what I'd like to do is talk about very quickly five reasons, overall reasons, and I think these have been summarized and touched on by all of the speakers so far this morning, but I'll give you my take on what the reasons might be for getting excited about cloud robotics. And then I'll talk about two of our projects here at Cal, depending if I have time. The transition is really slow. Interesting. All right. One of the big motivations is that we have huge, vast resources of data on almost every object one could imagine on the web. The second advantage is the availability of vast resources of computing. So we have, as we've already discussed, that we no longer need to think of the computing as being done on board. The third is the idea that the cloud is now facilitating the sharing of code and data and designs online. Obviously, everyone here is familiar with the developments at ROS, and the new Open Source Robotics Foundation has been really making great strides, and almost all of us are using those tools. I think that is also part of the story on cloud robotics. But I want to tell you another very quickly story about the idea that design can be facilitated by the cloud. And this goes back to last year when I had the chance to visit Ghana in Africa. And I discovered there that there were lots of students interested in robotics, primarily for education because it's very inspiring. The problem was that they were using the Lego Mindstorm system, and it's at the cost of $250 is prohibitive. So we decided to form a new organization that we call AFRON, the African Robotics Network. And our first mission was to set up a design challenge for people not only in Africa but all over the world to design ultra-affordable robots for education. That is extremely low cost. And somewhat as an unreachable goal, but just something to get people interested, we set the target as $10 robot. In other words, could you design a $10 robot that could be used for teaching all over the world? We launched this in the summer of 2012, and in the fall, in September, we had 28 submissions, and we selected 10 winners. And they're just tremendous ideas. I only have time to tell you about the number one winner, the grand prize, which was something that was designed by an inventor in Thailand called the Suckerbot. And it's a beautiful design. He took a surplus Sony game controller, modified it by taking the vibrational motors and turning them into wheel drivers. And then because he wanted to have the thumb switches be sensitive to having the robot bump into something, he needed some moment arms, and he attached two lollipops onto the ends of this. Now this is just, I think, a tremendous solution to the problem, because what he did was he basically created not only a compelling robot, but also with lollipops on top, so what kid could resist it? The amazing thing was that he put on his website all the details of how to build this yourself, and the price for all components comes out to $8.96. So we're now working with him and others to develop these and refine the design, and then we're hoping to have them produced ideally in Africa so that they'll be available to students all over the world. So this is an example, again, of what I think we're broadening our thinking about cloud robotics, is that the cloud also provides resources in terms of design. Another area is the idea that every once in a while, as we all know, a robot will be stuck. There's going to be some object in its environment that it's not familiar with. And what I'm excited about is that the cloud also offers the capability that when a robot is in such a situation and can recognize that because its confidence values are sufficiently low, it can then call on resources. In particular, it can call on humans. So you could have humans standing by. And this is a little reversal from the standard today where when a human calls, there's often a robot that picks up. Here a robot would call and a human would pick up. And I think this is realistic that we could imagine call centers that would be available to help on demand when robots need assistance. And this is somewhat related to what Mattia was talking about with the idea of human in the loop. I think, so these are what I consider the at least five reasons that we might love cloud robotics. The first one is the big data. There's lots of data, image maps, models that are being updated every day. There's the cloud computing idea that we have vast resources of computing that are particularly important for things I'm interested in, like statistical learning and sampling-based motion planning. There's the open source idea, exemplified by Ross, of sharing code and also by Afron's mechanical designs. The idea of collective robot learning, I'm also excited about, where robots can now share data and outcomes as they have experiences in the world. They can share the code that they've run and then the outcome, which will help a global center that would be able to process that and then help the ensemble to perform better. And the last one is crowdsourcing and call centers, that humans can be in the loop. And humans can be in the loop in a variety of different ways, but they can provide guidance on demand. There is, as we're seeing today, a very exciting group of researchers now making contributions to this area. And I have two proposals. One is that I've been starting to develop a survey of relevant references. And the link here at the bottom, which I'll send out after today, is a first draft of a survey. And what I'd like to do is get input from all of you at the workshop and add your papers, add your links to this, both the website and to this paper, because I'd like it to evolve over the next year to reflect lots of the activity that's going on. And in particular, I also think we might consider proposing a workshop together for ICRA in 2014. When the deadline will be in September, but I think now is an interesting time to start planning that. I won't go further in terms of slides, but I want to mention that we are working with Google. And it's related to some of the things that Mattia was talking about, that we're working on using their recognition engine that operates in the cloud to identify objects and then grasp them. We also have a project on shape uncertainty, where we do stochastic modeling and stochastic optimization in the cloud. And I'm also very interested in this new development from General Electric, which I don't know if everyone's heard about, but they call it the industrial internet. And there's a really interesting potential of industry becoming involved. So we might expand the definition to include not only robots, but also automation. Thank you.
Okay, good. So I had the question for Mati and Kaija. I actually have tons of questions, but I will just ask two. So I was wondering I think it's awesome. Like, it should be in the browser and everything. And if we need to ship these robots to homes like now, and whatever works for that is fair game. One question was that for the operator to get that the automation has failed, there needs to be some precious seconds that is wasted there. Like the robot tries to grasp something or do some action, and then the operator realizes that this is not working, I must control the situation. Is there a way of doing this in advance, that so that robot already, without even trying, just goes, oh, I can't do that. Like, I can't even grasp this thing. Or
yeah, that's an excellent question, and it's something that we've thought about quite a bit. Yes, and in this framework where the human is on call, the robot tries to do things autonomously and the human is on call to help, it's very important for autonomy to know when it needs help. And ideally, yes, we'd like the robot to call for help before it drops your expensive vase on the floor, right? And it's not an easy problem. In terms of grasping, for example, we worked last year and the year before this notion of probabilistic grasp planning, where you have the probability of success is baked into the algorithm. And ideally, if you know, many things that the robot does autonomously do have a notion of probability of success, then if that dips below a certain threshold, the robot can call the operator. It's not yet clear how everything the robot does will have a probability of success baked in. So that's probably a very interesting direction for research in this area.
But also, I mean, the robot already knows when it's not going to be able to motion plan to a spot, and a lot of things it already can check and know that the situation is no good and then ask the human for help. So it can't predict all things that it doesn't have in its model, but it does have a lot of things in its model already.
I mean, but I don't want to take so much time, so I will skip on. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Albert. Are there any other questions? Not just to the remote panelists, but also to the three speakers we have here. Do the panelists have questions to each other, maybe? I don't understand. Okay, why don't we get your question in the
back to the spot. So another question that I have is that, say that the robot is continually, at a certain home, is continually failing to open a some sort of cupboard or something. Like, it always requires assistance for that sort of damn cupboard. It can't just do it. Is there a way, and I know that this is hard and all that, but is there maybe a way of somehow improving the system over the through the true grasps? Like, the operator has grasped, opened the cupboard now 10 times, and hopefully the 11th time the system will update itself somehow.
Definitely, and it's something that we have thought about a lot and would definitely like to have in our system in an ongoing fashion. One thing that we have worked with Hai Nguyen at Georgia Tech, for instance, and he has done something very similar in that the robot tries and it adjusts its position of where it would like to, for instance, flip a light switch or open a drawer type things in order to make sure it has exactly the region that it will succeed in. And so that sort of thing could be used very easily for other things as well. And in general, if you have a world model and you have, for instance, a cabinet represented, and you know where it is and you know it's the same one, then at the very least you can just record when it succeeded and when it didn't and use only the grasps that succeeded.
And then another thing that we're doing that is related is ROS Commander, which is a tool that allows the operator to build behaviors. So if you've done something once, like say opening the fridge or opening a cabinet, you can record that as a predefined behavior, and then next time when you have to open the same drawer, you just reuse that behavior. And this tool allows you to apply existing behaviors to new places in the environment. It's sensor-based, so it adapts based on sensing for these new locations. And we think this is a very powerful paradigm because you can imagine shared behaviors over the internet. So many operators, many people build behaviors for robots that are then available in public libraries. And actually at ICRA, Hai is going to present our paper on ROS Commander, which has all the details.
A few points I still wanted to make at the end here. So one is, I think this meeting has been very interesting. I think it stresses the fact that there is a big cloud community, a cloud robotics community out there. We should do everything we can to get together. Ken talked about organizing a workshop. I think that's a great idea. Matteo, you mentioned that the RASCON is also an excellent event. There's also a Google Class group on cloud robotics, so I encourage everybody to join that. I think that is really going to be key to make this field move forward. What else did I want to say? So I wanted to thank very much, especially all the remote speakers who got up either very, very early or stayed up really, really late for joining us here today. I think we should have another round of applause just for them.